Good morning. Welcome to our live stream of First Reformed Oostburg. Speaking of which, let me just pull up the broadcast here and check myself, see how my hair looks. Okay. Looks pretty good. Okay. All right, cool. All right. Thank you so much for tuning in to join us in worshiping the Lord today. If we have any visitors out there, we welcome you. Thank you for joining us. All right. So we have a few announcements for you this morning. Kids, be sure to stay tuned after the service today, just like last week, for another devotional and singing time. Also, be ready to tune in on Wednesday at 6 p.m. For FRC's YouTube channel and the church Facebook page, or at frcoosburg.org for the premiere of the FRC's Bible class online. And you'll be able to connect with the children's ministry through the chat feature. It'll be pretty cool. Also, kids, we also need your help. Please look to cut out your paper palm branches to use during the worship service next week, Sunday. If you need those materials, you can pick them up in the red box under the carport. It would be great if your parents could email Lori a picture of you waving it by this week, Thursday, April 2nd. We might even use it in next Sunday's worship service. Email them to ltaylor@frcoosburg.org or email her if you didn't find any supplies in the red box. All right, 6 through 12 students, I believe that Toby has an announcement from the shed where we will be live streaming our first virtual youth gathering. Toby, are you there?
Thanks, Justin. All right. Hey, what's up, FRC Youth? Got it all figured out. FRC's first ever virtual youth gathering will be taking place this Wednesday, April 1st. No joke, okay? Junior high will go from 6:30 to 7 o'clock. High school, it'll be 7:15 to 7:45. Now, each student should have received an email calendar invite that you can access on your Chromebooks. So from there, okay, on Wednesday night, just click the link that says join Hangouts Meet at the designated time, which is 5 minutes early. And it might ask you to download the Hangouts Meet app, but you have permission to do that. Once you click join, be sure to shut your microphone off and then follow the on-screen instructions we'll have for you. Probably keep in mind that headphones will probably work best for this. But yeah, it's going to be a virtual blast. All right, send it back to you, Justin.
Thanks, Toby. Our FRC deacons are offering to assist our church members who are at a high risk by running errands. If you would like the assistance, call the church office. If no one is in the office, just leave a message on Pastor Brian's voicemail, which is extension 305. Another option is you can make a request via email to Pastor Brian at btaylor@frcoosburg.org. If you have any questions or you didn't receive our new weekly email and you would like to be sure, call into the church office tomorrow or sometime during the office hours this week, and you can get FRC's digital bulletin online at frcoosburg.org in the news menu. Or if you would like a bulletin announcement sheet mailed to you each week, please call the church office for that. That is one main way that we would want to stay in contact with you is through that church bulletin. So with that, let's go to our Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much that we're able to still worship together as you as a church. Even though we don't have all of you together in one room, we are all together online and through you and our connection through you as one big family of God. Thank you so much that we can still meet like this, and we just ask that you'd be with all those who are sick and that you would heal them as soon as possible. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our first song this morning is Lead Me to the Cross. Again, if you can join with us and sing with those around you audibly, that's awesome. But singing in your heart and keeping him in mind as we continue. Easter's still coming, and we're excited for that. And we're still in this season of Lent and how God is wanting to move in and through us. He's worthy of our praise and worship, so let's do that together this morning.
Thank you. redemption's hill, where your blood was spilled. For my ransom, everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Bring me to myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me to the cross. You were as I, tempted and tried. Sin and death. Now you're risen. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay.
Our word from God's word today comes to us from Psalm 46, 1. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. And we encourage you to recite those words throughout the week and spend some time praying around those words from Psalm 46, 1. Please join me as we go to God in prayer. Father, we thank you that you are our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in our time of need. And in the midst of all the waiting and all the uncertainties that come with these days, we give thanks that you are faithful, that indeed you are our refuge and strength. And we thank you for your mercies that come new with each day. Thank you for continuing to provide for our needs day after day, 365 days a year, 24 hours a day. And Lord, help us in these days to find new ways of connecting with you, to be reminded of your presence with us. We ask also that you would help us to find new ways of connecting with each other during these days of practicing social distancing. We give thanks, God, for the various technologies that you have given to us, which allow us to stay connected, even to the point that we can gather around our television screens, our computers, and our tablets to come together to worship you today. We lift to you those who are feeling isolated as a result of the safer at home policy. God, help us to reach out to those who are feeling disconnected. And we pray, Lord, for those who are providing care for those who are in care facilities as they are separated from family and friends. Use those caregivers to be your hands and your feet. We also pray for doctors and nurses who are coming into contact with those who have contracted COVID-19. Protect them and give them an extra measure of strength, as many of them are called to work extended hours. We also uplift to you those who are unemployed and those whose hours have been reduced, as well as those who are business owners who have had to close or have had a less stream of income. We ask, God, that you would provide for all of their needs. And we lift to you those from our church family who are receiving physical therapy. We think of Linda Vanderweely and Tom Horn and Phyllis Parrish. We pray, Lord, that you would use their therapies to give them renewed strength and increased mobility. We pray for healing for those who are receiving treatments for cancer. We think of Gene Coles and E.J. Kalyao, as well as Verla Westerbeek. We pray that their treatments will continue to be effective with only minimal side effects. We also uplift to you Ruth Ann Dryers as she receives pain management therapy. God, we pray that that therapy will be effective in reducing her pain. And Father, meet each of these persons at their point of need. Assure them of your presence with them. Use the care that they are receiving to bring healing. We also lift to you Francine DeMaster and her family in the passing of her mother-in-law, Dorothy DeMaster. Comfort them with your presence as well as with your promises. We pray for our kids as they resume school through an online format this week. God, help them and their families to adjust to a new way of learning. And we just pray, Lord, for the adjustments that will come with that new format. We continue to pray for Kyle and Janie Wenig and their work with Athletes in Action and the special challenges that they face of not being able to do ministry in person. God, help them to use other means to stay connected with the students that they minister to. And we pray, Lord, that our special offering this month will just be an encouragement to them in their ministry. We also uplift to you our partner in mission, Rick Cawthon, and his work with Good News Jail and Prison Ministry at the Sheboygan County Detention Center. God, we give thanks that he has been asked to continue, and we thank you that he can have interaction with inmates. Use him to be the light of Jesus to those inmates, and give him an extra measure of strength as he attempts to continue Bible studies that previously were led by volunteers. Use him and the staff to be a calming presence in the midst of anxiousness. And we pray for wisdom in regard to their fundraising banquet that's scheduled for the end of April. God, we pray that you'll either allow that to happen or just give them the opportunity to reschedule it for another time. We lift to you our nation. We pray for President Trump, for those who advise him. Give him wisdom in making decisions which honor you. Father, use these days to bring us closer to you and use us to share the hope that we have in you. Hear our prayer as we lift it to you in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
What a blessing is, what a peace is like. Amen. Indeed, we come leaning on those everlasting arms of Jesus as we turn to God's Word for us for today. And as we turn to God's Word, we're going to do this a little bit differently today. We're going to actually read that Word as we go through our sermon this morning. So I would ask you to go ahead and have your Bibles out and ready to go. You've got nothing else better to do. We're going to go through four chapters of Scripture this morning in our lesson. I'm just kidding. It won't be quite that long. That you don't have to worry. We're still going to do our normal thing, but as far as time goes, but we are going to kind of travel through four different chapters in the book of Judges, and we're going to begin in chapter 13. So have your Bibles open there as we read bits and pieces of some of these chapters together. As we begin this morning, I want you to think for a moment about your grandparents' house. It's amazing to me how many memories that I have of my grandparents' houses. Different things that happened while there for whatever reason in those homes. Memories that continue to kind of flood back from time to time and bring those things back to life again as I remember those experiences there as myself with my grandparents or maybe with my family or even with extended family, with cousins and aunts and uncles and those kind of things enjoying time together at their house. But one thing that sticks out about my grandparents who lived in Sheldon, Iowa, was that house was very particular. My grandmother was just a little itty-bitty thing, and I think it was because she never stopped moving. She was constantly cleaning and tidying things up. Every once in a while, she would allow us to go upstairs, but most of the time, we weren't allowed upstairs. They could, their bedroom and stuff was on the main floor, so there was really no use of that upstairs that happened once all the kids were out of the house. And so in that house, if you did get upstairs, you saw that she still even dusted up there and that the beds were like military beds. They were, you could flip a coin on these beds. The blankets were so neat. She kept their house very particular. And just to give you a little bit of an idea this morning, I brought something back from that time. They had this truck, and this was my favorite thing to play with at their house. This truck is a cool truck. I mean, you know, they don't make trucks like this anymore. This is a sturdy, heavy metal truck. And my grandparents had hardwood floors in their house. And this truck, one of the coolest things about this truck, even though it's got this great flatbed, and there used to be panels that could go in some slots that are here in this flatbed so you could haul livestock with it, and there was a livestock chute that would hook on the back. But one of the coolest things about this truck was these hard rubber wheels. And when you ran these across those hardwood floors, it went, vroom, vroom, and it was great. Making noise, what every young boy loves to do, right? This truck was awesome for that. Well, my particular grandmother didn't always appreciate that noise, nor what she was worried these hard rubber wheels would do to her floor. So if you can believe this, she actually knit out of yarn covers for these wheels. And she would put those on there so that when we played with this thing, it was virtually silent going across the floors. It not only took all the fun of the noise out of it, but it really didn't make it look very cool either. But that's how particular she was about her house. So you kind of get the idea of how she kept it. And so it was amazing once in a while when she allowed us as cousins to actually go upstairs, into that upstairs and play. Now their house was a two-story house set back kind of a little bit on an alley. There were no good shots for most streetlights to get to the house. And so when you went upstairs, we would shut all the lights off and play hide and seek in the dark. You could lay down in the hallway of that upstairs and someone could walk right past you. It was so dark in that upstairs. But there was one spot where the blinds in the window didn't quite cover the whole window, and the light would creep through. And if you knew what you were doing, you could put yourself in a position so that you could see the shadows of others moving in the house, and you had a distinct advantage in the game. Shadows in the darkness. We pick up reading today in the book of Judges, and I have an image for you to think about. Shadows in the darkness. It's a really dark time now in Israel. It is really dark. Samson marks the last of the judges. And I'm not even sure, really, if you include him. I mean, we do, but boy, the job he does as a judge leaves a lot to be desired. Now, I'm sorry if you still, from your childhood, because I know I did as a child, would lift up Samson as this biblical hero. But when we study him, we realize hero, not so much. As we begin looking at Samson's life, we're going to realize that this darkness that is on Israel really is reflected very profoundly in him and his life. We're going to realize that this darkness shows very clearly in how he lives out his calling as a judge in Israel. We're going to realize that this cycle that I've talked about of Israel turning away from God, falling into trouble, crying out to God, having God send a judge to deliver them, that cycle which has progressed them into a deeper sense of darkness has really come to an extreme amount of darkness at this time. So let's turn to that first reading of our scripture as we bring that to the screen of Judges 13, 1 through 5. The Israelites, again, did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. And the Lord gave them into the hand of the Philistines 40 years. There was a certain man of Zorah, who of the tribe of the Danites, whose name was Manoah. His wife was barren, having borne no children. And an angel of the Lord appeared to the woman and said to her, "Although you are barren, having borne no children, you shall conceive and bear a son. Now be careful not to drink wine or strong drink or to eat anything unclean, for you shall conceive and bear a son, and no razor is to come on his head, for the boy shall be a Nazarite to God from birth. It is he who shall begin to deliver Israel from the hand of the Philistines." So some very important things for us to recognize in this scripture. First of all, the Israelites are continuing the cycle, right? They're wandering away from God and doing what's right in their own eyes. Important for us to remember that and to put that kind of in our minds. So much so are they wandering, do we hear what happens in this story? So this angel of the Lord comes to announce to Manoah's wife the coming of a judge, the birth of her upcoming son. Now, it's sort of interesting, right? How many times in Scripture don't we hear something similar to this? Right? God's promises coming to a couple who can't have kids, Abraham and Sarah, Zechariah and Elizabeth. And now here we have Manoah and his wife, unable to have children, and God brings his promise, his hope, in their son to be this next judge. And he is to be a Nazarite. Okay, what does that mean? Let's go to this slide that kind of gives you an image of what that Nazarite vow is about. Okay, that Nazarite vow is that you'll refrain from unclean things. A dead body typically is something that's considered unclean, not to mention all the foods and things that the Israelites considered unclean would go with that, as well as no wine or strong drink. And for him, for especially the Nazarite, you don't cut the hair. No razor shall come to their head. Their hair shall grow. And so this is the vow of this kind of extra setting apart of these individuals. And here of this one is to be born to them, their son, Samson, to be set apart in this way. Now remember, how is Israel existing in our world at this time? God has chosen them. Why? To set them apart as a people. We can begin to see these connections that are here. Now, it's interesting what happens after this is the wife runs off to tell Manoah what's just happened. And he hears this, and he's having a hard time kind of understanding this, hard time kind of believing this, and knowing exactly what to do. So he wants to seek God for further instructions of what it means that they should raise this child as a Nazirite. Now that should tell us something already, that he doesn't understand what this means when the term Nazirite is used. And so he calls out, pleads to God, and God sends again this angel of the Lord back, but this time, again, just to his wife. But this time the wife says, hey, can you stay here a minute? And she runs off and gets Manoah and brings him back. And again, we see this further progression through Manoah and his wife of Israel. Because they come back and they ask, what do we need to do in raising this child? And he says, just what I told her, that Nazirite vow. And then what does Manoah try to do? But he tries to give an offering of food to the angel. And the angel says, no, this is not me that you need to focus on. If you want to do anything to show your gratitude, you provide an offering to the Lord. Give a burnt offering to the Lord. Manoah pushes him further and tries to kind of find that way and says, well, at least tell me your name. And it's interesting, the angel responds very interestingly and says, it's too wonderful for you. Because this is an angel of the Lord. Again, the angel does not want to identify himself because he wants the focus on the Lord. And that's what's missing in Manoah and his wife's response. They're not understanding this, understanding what this means. So we see how they are losing this understanding of what it means to be this people set apart, to be God's people, to be the people of Israel themselves, as this vow is being lost. So as we come to the end of chapter 13, his wife, Manoah's wife, conceives and bears a son, and she names him Samson, and the Lord blesses him as he grows. And it says at the end of that chapter that the Spirit of the Lord begins to stir in him. Okay? That's kind of important, begins, because if you remember right, remember back to what we did read already in 13, it said he will begin to deliver Israel from the hand of the Philistines. So now let's pick up our reading again. We'll go to Judges 14. We're going to read verses 1 through 4 of that chapter. Once Samson went down to Timnah, and at Timnah he saw a Philistine woman. Then he came up and told his father and mother, I saw a Philistine woman at Timnah. Now, get her for me as my wife. But his father and mother said to him, is there not a woman among your kin or among all our people that you must go and take a wife from the uncircumcised Philistines? But Samson said this to his father, get her for me because she pleases me. His father and his mother did not know that this was from the Lord, for he was seeking a pretext to act against the Philistines. At that time, the Philistines had dominion over Israel. So now we begin to get a little bit of an idea of this personality of Samson. And it's not so positive, is it? In fact, I would almost say, as I hear his responses in this, a bit of almost a spoiled brat kind of action, right? I don't care what you say, just get her for me. Do what I'm telling you to do. It's really what he does. Now again, we have to remember in there that it also talks about that the Lord had this happening so that it would be all this part against the Philistines. But we have to understand something in here, that beginning. Again, Samson's beginning to understand. So he's kind of coming to an edge of understanding that he is supposed to be kind of doing something for Israel with the Philistines and not to like the Philistines. And that's, I think, about as far as it gets for him. He's not fully understanding, grasping this call and how he is supposed to live out this idea, concept, calling of being a judge. Because we're going to see as we go through this how he continues to fail, in a sense, at doing this. One thing, very important that we look at in this passage. Remember what I said earlier in that first passage about Israel doing what was right in their own eyes, kind of coming away from God? Well, let's see that again. This is something we see repeated in Judges a number of times. Israel did what was right in its own eyes. Israel does what is right in its own eyes. What does Samson say to his father when he says, can't you find, you know, a woman that's of our own people? He says, get her for me because she's pleases me. She looks good to me. She seems right to me in my own eyes. When you get to kind of the literal part of the Hebrew there, that's what he's really saying to them. Get her because she looks right to my eyes. He thinks she's a babe. You know, that's he was focused totally on what he wants. So we begin to see that our judge is not such a good judge, being shown right here in his character himself. So his parents do what their child demands. Isn't that interesting, right? We can get into a whole nother lesson there, but we'll leave that be where it is, right? And they go with him down to Timnah to make arrangements for the marriage, to go ahead and offer whatever they need to offer to get this to happen. And as they do that, somehow it seems that Samson gets separated from them because they don't realize this next little story that goes on. This is one of those famous stories we like to hear of Samson. Samson is kind of separated from them. He's walking through a vineyard, and suddenly out comes a young lion that roars at him. And we assume that means it comes to attack him. All right? We have an image here for us to think of there, right? This is tend to be maybe what we think of as we think of Samson wrestling with this lion. Now, I had a hard time finding an image I really liked for this because, one, every image you find of Samson, I mean, this guy is pretty well built, right? He's got some guns on him. But there's some images out there that make him look like The Rock. All right? I mean, it's just, I can't believe it. There is nothing in Scripture that says Samson was built, that he was, you know, looked strong, that he was muscular. In fact, the only thing we find out about him is that the Philistines continually wonder, what is the secret of his strength? So I'm not so sure he was this well-built guy like this. And it also says a young lion, and I don't know, every picture I found had a lion with a full mane on it, and if I think a young lion, I don't necessarily think that. So again, the images that sometimes we have are maybe not always correct, but this kind of gives us that idea, but still, that he's out there wrestling with this lion. But before he enters it, the passage says something very important in there. If you're looking through, it says the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. The Spirit of the Lord comes upon Samson, and he goes into this wrestling match with this lion, and this is rather graphic, but he literally tears this thing apart, pulls it into pieces, and kills it. And then he goes off to Timnah to join his parents for the finishing of this deal on his wife-to-be. That gets done. He goes back home. And then later, he comes back to Timnah for the wedding. Now, he's coming back to Timnah for the wedding. He's not bringing a bunch of people with him because the Israelites are not going to gather around with the Philistines for this. They don't approve of this marrying outside of their people. So there's that sense. He's gathering. So only people that are going to be present here that we know of are guests of the bride's side, that these people, these Philistines from Timnah, are gathered there. And maybe that's part of what Samson wanted. We don't know. He did seem to have a pretty devious, trickster kind of mind. And so he starts things off with a bang and says, you know what? I don't think you guys are smart enough for me. I have a riddle for you. And it's a riddle that he offers them that is almost, well, not even almost, it's impossible for anyone to get. You see, on his way to the wedding, being a typical young guy, I suppose, hey, I'm going to go back and take a look at that lion that I killed and check out that dead rotting carcass, you know? He goes back to look at the lion. And while he's doing that, he sees that in the carcass, a swarm of bees is there, and they've created a hive, and there's honey. And he begins to take out that honey. Now, this is disgusting to us today to think about, right? So he's digging in this carcass to pull out honeycomb and honey, and he begins to eat it. Now remember who he is, folks. He's a Nazirite. He's not paying attention to anything that goes with it. He's touching a dead body, and not only touching it, he's eating from what he finds inside, and he's offering it to his parents This is completely far away from who he's called to be and how he's called to live as a Nazarite. And so now he makes this bet with the Philistines there. I bet you can't solve this riddle. And they say, yeah, we can. And so he offers them this riddle. Out of the eater came something to eat. Out of the strong came something sweet. So how are they supposed to know this? No one else is around when he kills the lion. No one else is around when he finds the honey in the lion. His parents don't know where it comes from. Only Samson knows what happened. This is the impossible riddle that he puts to them. For 3 days, they wrestle. Because you got to remember, weddings took a long time then. For 3 days, they wrestle with this riddle. And I can imagine the whole time he's just laughing at them and amused by the fact that they are never going to get the answer to this. And so he gets them upset enough. They go to his wife. She's a Philistine. They go to this girl from their hometown. And I don't know what your versions say, but mine said that they coaxed her. Read on, folks. They didn't coax her. They threatened her. Right? If you don't find out the answer to this riddle, we're going to burn you and your family. They threaten her. Her life, her family's life is now on the line. What do you think she's going to do? So she starts beguiling Samson, right? Using her charms, the fact that he finds her attractive. She starts just doing everything she can. It kind of talks about it as she kind of kept pressing him or nagging him. I think it was probably a lot of those different things, along with whatever emotional persuading she could do to get him to give up the answer. And finally, he does. And we continue to see that this strong man has more than just his hair being lost as a weakness. He has a lot of weaknesses in his character as a person. And so we find that she gets the answer, she presents it to the other Philistines, and on the fourth day, they present the answer to Samson. And he is upset. Now, we're not sure if he expected this or not when he tells her this, if this is all part of kind of a twisted plan that he has, but he uses this as a reason to get upset. And the word he uses to call them cheaters is interesting. He said, if you hadn't plowed with my heifer, you wouldn't know the answer. I guess that's a saying for back then. I don't know. But we can kind of make idea of what he means by that. And he's basically calling them cheaters. And so to justify what he does next, to fulfill his vow, which was to go out and get 32 wedding garments, that was the bet. Fine wedding garments. This was an expensive thing. He goes off to another Philistine town, attacks 32 men, killing them, and taking their fine wedding garments and brings them back to present them to the people of this town as his way of exacting revenge for their cheating. This, of course, causes some great tension and problem. So Samson actually leaves. His wife in Timnah seems to go back home or whatever, but he's gone for a period of time. And he's not there. And that gets us to the end of 14. And then you go into chapter 15, and some interesting things happen in 15 as well. So now it's the time of the harvest, and Samson decides that he misses his wife. And so he takes an offering for her father, kind of a peace offering, back along with him to go there and try to appease things and make things right. And he goes back there and finds out that the father says to him, you know what? When you didn't stick around, I figured that meant you didn't want her. You were rejecting her, so I gave her to someone else. And now Samson says, if I wasn't justified before in what I did, I'm fully justified now in what I'm about to do in causing trouble for the Philistines. And the next thing he does is another one of those stories that we often would hear about. He goes out and captures 300 foxes. And he takes those foxes and he ties them. This guy obviously had no regard really for animals, you know. He ties them tail to tail and puts a torch of fire between them. Now, animals don't like fire, right? And it's the harvest. So you've got shocks of grain gathered in standing up, drying in the fields to be threshed, waiting. They're drying. At this time of the year, the olive groves and the vineyards are all pushing the fruit of the vine, the juice and life of the vine, into the fruit to produce. You can imagine what happens as that fire travels through the land of Timnah, these fox running wild, going crazy out of fear, fire everywhere, harvest destroyed everywhere in Timnah. And that makes a huge impact for them. You want to really get somebody upset? Attack their livelihood, right? And so they come after Samson. The Philistines are done messing around. They come after him. They can't find him because he's on the lam. He's hiding out somewhere in a cave, and he doesn't want to be found. So they go, and they say, fine. And they raid Lehi in Judah, this city. And as they're raiding the city, taking what they need to survive, right? That's their harvest has been taken away. They're raiding the city for what they need and taking out revenge on Samson. The people of the city say, why are you doing this to us? What did we do? Samson is the answer. And so those people in Judah say, what if we get Samson for you? Because that's what you want. They say, that's fine. So they go, evidently knew where Samson was hiding. They find him and say, look, you've got to go back with us. The Philistines are going to kill us. So Samson says, I will go back if you promise not to hurt me, attack me. He lets them bind him with two new ropes. So new ropes, again, you got to think of our more, you know, they have more moisture in them. They're wetter, so they're stronger, harder to break. They bind him with two new ropes. They take him back, and he gets there back, and the Philistines, I'm sure, are thinking, oh, look, here he comes, all bound and ready for us to take. And suddenly he breaks free of those ropes like they're nothing. The Spirit of the Lord, it says again, comes upon him. He breaks free from those, grabs the jawbone of a donkey, and kills 1,000 men. It's an amazing story. And what happens at the end of it continues to give us great insight. If you look at the end of chapter 15, it says, okay, he's just killed 1,000 people. He says, I'm thirsty. Well, no wonder. You've had quite a workout, right? It's no wonder you're thirsty. And so he says to the Lord, while you gave your servant this victory, now are you going to let me die out here of thirst? Again, while he does give some credit to God for the victory, the focus comes back on, I need water. It's almost like his parents, right? Get me this woman. God, get me something to drink because, you know, I'm thirsty. It's interesting here the tie that one can make from Israel wandering through the wilderness after being delivered from Egypt. And they're thirsty. They need something to drink, and they're crying out, whining to God, saying, you brought us out here in the wilderness to die. As if God would go through all of that deliverance stuff just to let them die out there. As if God doesn't know what Samson's need is in this moment. And God speaks to Moses, right? And he strikes the rock and water comes gushing forth from the rock. Well, here with Samson, a rock splits and water comes out so that he may drink. Again, another story of the faithlessness of Samson being tied into that faithlessness of Israel in that wandering in the wilderness. A really powerful thing for us to understand here as we look at this person, this judge of Samson. Now we get into our last chapter, chapter 16. And as we begin to think about it, I did have a picture, if you want to move on, of we're going to of the Samson breaking free of the ropes. But let's go now. We're going to get into chapter 16, so you can go back to those verses 4 through. But I want to quick speak about 1 through 3, because I think we need to hear that story too quick. Right before the story that we're always so familiar with of Samson and Delilah, we get this short little story of Samson in those first three verses. Samson, again, lets his love of women get the best of him, and he takes off to Gaza and goes to see a prostitute there. And while he's with the prostitute there, the Philistines think, we've got him now, he's there. He's going to spend that night with the prostitute, and we'll catch him in the morning unawares. He comes out of her place. Instead, Samson somehow seems to know that they're out there, so he gets up in the middle of the night and sneaks away, and he does something interesting. He goes to the city gate, and he rips it from its foundation. The Spirit of the Lord, in a sense, is with him again, rips up that city gate, and he hauls it out to the top of the hill outside the city. Remember, in that day, to capture a city gate meant you had victory over the city. So Samson here is kind of providing a sense of victory, arrogance, over the Philistines here in that story. Now we come to our verses, beginning at verse 4. After this, he fell in love with a woman in the valley of Sorek, whose name was Delilah. The lords of the Philistines came to her and said to her, "Coax him and find out what makes his strength so great, and how we may overpower him, so that we may bind him in order to subdue him, and we will each give you 1,100 pieces of silver." So Delilah said to Samson, "Please tell me what makes your strength so great, and how you could be bound, so that one could subdue you." Samson said to her, "If they bind me with 7 fresh bowstrings that are not dried out, then I shall become weak and be like anyone else." Then the lords of the Philistines brought her 7 fresh bowstrings that had not dried out, and she bound him with them. While the men were lying in wait in an inner chamber, she said to him, "The Philistines are upon you, Samson." But he snapped the bowstrings as a strand of fiber snaps when it touches the fire. So the secret of his strength was not known. So Samson continues, in a sense, to play these games with the Philistines, and here with Delilah. And he does it here in this story, and he would repeat this because she would continue to press him, continue to try to beguile him. And 2 more times she would, the next time she would tell him, or he would tell her that, you know, again, the fresh ropes thing. Put 2 fresh ropes on me and I won't be able to break free. And that he does that again. And then he says, "Well, if you take the hairs of my head and you weave them together and pin me into a weaving loom, in the pin of the weaving loom, I won't be able to get away." And so she does that, and he jumps up right away again, and he's free again. And she's finally kind of at her wit's end, and she's like, "You know what? You must not love me at all. Your heart is not with me," she says to him. "You know, you won't tell me really what the secret of your strength is." And he went after her, she went after him and after him, and finally he said to her that a razor has never come upon my head because I am a Nazirite. He tells her the truth, "And if you would shave my head, I would be like anyone else." It's interesting to hear that comment, right? He's telling her of the promise, but he is still seeing his strength in his hair, in this kind of physical nature that is him, instead of the Spirit of the Lord coming upon him, which is what has happened each time he shows this powerful strength, right? Samson still does not recognize God, does not recognize him as the source of his ability, the source of his strength. Samson just again shows us that he doesn't know God. And so Delilah learns this, and so she does what he told her they could do. And she gets him to fall asleep in her lap, and while he's sleeping has someone come in and shave his head. Again, hard to find good images of these things, but here's what we have. And he's able to be bound and captured. And they take him away, and they figure, just in case, they gouge out his eyes. Because if his strength comes back, at least he can't see, and it's a lot easier to deal with a blind, strong man than one who can see. And so they gouge out his eyes and they put him in the prison where he would turn the mill like an animal to grind the grain. So that's what he was doing. That's where Samson had fallen to. And then one day we have something happen. So as he's grinding grain one day, the Philistines are having a big party. They're celebrating that they've got him captured. They're celebrating that their god Dagon has given them victory over Samson. It's a key in this. Even the Philistines don't recognize God because of Israel, because of Samson. They're saying that they gained victory over Samson. And so they're throwing a big party and sacrificing to their god Dagon, and they say, you know what, bring him out so he can entertain us. So they're going to bring out Samson to entertain him, and they've got him in chains, and he's going to do the entertaining. And he asks the one who's leading him around like an animal, right, to put him by the pillars of the inner pillars of the house so that he can rest on them. And so that is done. And there's 3,000 people gathered in this house. And now let's pick up our reading, which starts in verse 28. Then Samson called to the Lord and said, Lord God, remember me and strengthen me only this once, O God, so that with this one act of revenge, I may pay back the Philistines for my two eyes. And Samson grasped the two middle pillars on which the house rested, and he leaned his weight against them, his right hand on the one and his left hand on the other. Then Samson said, let me die with the Philistines. He strained with all his might, and the house fell on the lords and all the people who were in it. So those he killed at his death were more than those he had killed during his life. Then his brothers and all his family came down and took him and brought him up and buried him between Zorah and Eshtaol in the tomb of his father Manoah. He had judged Israel 20 years. Now again, we have to notice some very powerful things in this end of the passage. Still, we have Samson, even though here for the first time, recognizes God, right? For the first time in all his life, we hear him actually call out to God, pray to God, go to God for help, recognizing that his strength would come from God. It's the first time he turns to God and says, God, this one time, as if the other times God hadn't done it, this one time, help me. And so God comes and helps him once again, and he is able to bring that whole house down on all those people. But again, notice his focus. Why does he want the strength this one time? So that I may gain revenge on the Philistines. Not once through this whole thing did you ever hear, or will you ever read, if you look through this on your own, him talk about delivering Israel. Not once will you hear Samson refer to himself in a sense of being a leader. Not once will he try to gather the people together to lead them, to try to be the one who would bring peace to the land, or the land would rest. Remember, we talked about that last week. In those times of peace, in the early days of the judges, it talked about that, and the land rested for so many years. You go back to Ehud, the land rested for 80 years. You go back to Deborah, the land rested for 40 years after her reign, with her reign, because there was peace, because they followed God. But you don't see any of that with Gideon. You don't see any of that with Jephthah. And now we for sure don't even see a trace of it with Samson. Samson has led, really not even led, has lived his life for himself. Has lived his life as one who kind of sought out to try to have this personal agenda with the Philistines. It wasn't about God's glory. It wasn't about God's plan. And this is where we have to remember, why and how did God call his people, right? This is where it's key that the Philistines are sacrificing to Dagon and giving thanks because they had delivery from Samson in capturing him. God calls them to be blessed, to be a blessing, right? The Abrahamic covenant. Blessed to be a blessing. The nations of the world were to be blessed through them. By their faithfulness to God and God's faithfulness then to them, that was supposed to be set up in such a way that they would be blessed. We often read these stories about the Amalekites and the Ammonites and the Moabites and the Philistines, and we think God hates them, and that's really not what's in this story at all. Never in Scripture does it say God hates these people. But God has sought to call his people to live in faithfulness so that others will witness who God is. And that's what we see not happening here in Samson. That nobody is recognizing God. Right? Nobody is recognizing God in this. But yet, right? God still is present. Little slivers of phrases through this entire life of Samson. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. And the Spirit of the Lord began to stir in him. And the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon him so that he could do this. Time and time again, the Spirit of the Lord showed its ability to be with Samson, to use him, that others may recognize him. And here in this final moment, again, God does an amazing act of mercy and grace in hearing Samson's request and doing what he asked to happen so that God's name, the first time Samson would actually recognize God, that God's name could be proclaimed in his story, that God is the one who acts, that God, who is the one who is providing the shadows, moving in this darkness, that his light still is there. This light that would continue in this battle against the Philistines that would go on through King David. This light that would continue on through the Old Testament and come to fruition in Jesus Christ. The light would come into the world and shine. This light shines. In moments like this, we have to ask ourselves, in light of this story, where are we living? How are we living in our world? Are we living so that we can be blessed to be a blessing? In this time, people are asking a lot of different questions. We're saying, oh, everything is so uncertain. The truth is, brothers and sisters, today is no different than a year ago. Nothing is more certain today than it was then. We're not promised anything in any day. Every day is uncertain. We're not promised each day. But the faithfulness of God causes the sun to rise and the sun to set. It's not our routines. It's not just science. It's the faithfulness of God continuing to spin and create life, continuing to work in our lives. That's the light that shines, causing the shadows and the darkness, that we might see God on the move and know that God is active, that God is alive and well around us. Because God is certain. God still cares. What is our verse for this week from Psalm 46? An ever-present help. Ever-present. God is still with us. May we be with him. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us pray. Ever-present God, our refuge, our strength, we give you praise. We give you praise for who you are and how you have revealed yourself, that even when we are at our worst, at our darkest, you are still there, waiting to use us in some sign of our faithfulness to you, that your glory might be revealed. So God, help us to see in this time maybe where we're putting priority in things that we shouldn't. Help us to see, oh God, where we're putting our needs in places where we should not. And help us to put our need on you, our trust in you and you alone. For you are God, and you are faithful, and you are mighty, and you are loving and merciful, and we can trust in you. Fill us, O God, with faith today and every day, because you are certain. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters, as we take time now to, in a sense, give of ourselves, as we talked about last week, we give of our offerings, and if we encourage you to be able to do that still, that you can do that practice of self of discipline, spiritual discipline of giving, and we have providing a number of ways in which you can do it. You can do it online. You can go to our website. You can go online there and give that way. You can mail it in via the regular mail, the postal service. Or it can be dropped off here at church. And if you go to the email we sent out, there's more detail to that. Or call into the church office, and they can give you instructions on how you can support the church in this time. But most importantly, how you continue to give of yourself to our God in this time, because that's what it's about. And so we come now to give of ourselves in our offering time, our gifts, our messes, and everything else that we are. We come to bring that before God. And as we do so, Kay is going to lead us in the ministry of music, and others are going to come up and paint again as a sign of us giving of ourselves to our God in worship.
By the blood. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, go forth knowing that our hope is in Jesus and Him alone. And may you go forth in faith, knowing that the presence of our God, the faithfulness of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit, go with you. And all of God's people said, Amen.
Closing song is Lion and the Lamb.
Every chain will break, His broken hearts declare.
for joining us, church. Kids, keep tuned. Stay tuned. We're going to run the announcements, and then we'll be ready with Ms. Lori doing the devotion and singing time.
Hi, kids. I'm glad that we get to connect again together today. Today we learned another interesting story. We learned about Samson. And if I were to ask you about Samson and what he was best known for, I have a feeling that I would guess what you're saying right now. You can all just yell it out. Even though it's really quiet in the sanctuary, I can guess that at home, you were probably saying that Samson was known for his strength, because he was. So you guys are gonna have a chance to make a little Samson, kind of like the one I made. I'm not an artist, kid, sorry. Because you have a little shape of a person, as well as something to make hair for Samson. And you can color on clothing, and even though mine has paper clothing on, just in case you don't have any other construction paper at home. So, we have this story of Samson, who's known for being so strong. But I'd say it's only partially right to say that he was strong. You see, Samson didn't always make very good decisions. Samson, in fact, made a lot of really bad decisions. And he made those decisions over and over again. Samson was known for his long hair. And his long hair, again, sorry about the design work here, but his long hair is what was said to give him his strength. Because before he was even born, an angel of the Lord appeared to his mom and told him never to cut his hair. But one of the times that Samson was making a really poor choice, he messed up big. And in that process, his hair ended up getting cut. You'll notice, kids, that we're not using any scissors here because it's never a good idea to be, you know, talking about cutting hair. So we're just gonna fold Samson's hair back a little bit. And when Samson had his hair cut, he lost his strength. And when he lost his strength, he was captured. And he went through some really dark days. Well, as Samson was in captivity, his hair started to grow again. And as his hair started to grow, Samson grew in strength as well. One day his captors brought him to a big gathering they were having. They were honoring a god that wasn't the one true God. And they were also laughing at Samson. Well, they placed Samson in between two pillars. And they were large pillars. And Samson called out to the Lord and asked for strength. And at that time, Samson knocked down the pillars, and the whole temple collapsed on all the people there who were not worshiping the one true God. Just like Samson, you and I can rely on the one true God, friends. We have that hope that we can trust in him. But hopefully it won't take as much as it did for our friend Samson, who made bad mistakes over and over again. Have fun making your Samson, friends. Couple things before we get to singing our song. You'll also find that in your goodie bag, we have something that looks like this. It's supposed to look kind of like a palm branch. And what I'd love for you kids to do is sometime in the next couple days to cut it out. And then maybe you can have your mom and dad take a picture of you waving your palm branch. You can go, cheese or palm, and they'll take a picture and they can email it to me. And you might just find that we'll use your picture during worship next Sunday. All right. When we're done singing today, you guys can take out a Starburst from the bag and enjoy it. Since we talked about a big God, a God that was large and in charge, it's kind of appropriate that we would sing Super Wonderful today. Remember that our God is super large, super strong, super wonderful God. Again, it's super wonderful, no finger up, and then God pointing to him. Have a great week, friends. Stay healthy, and you know what? I'll see you on Wednesday night at 6 o'clock.